568. Song after the opening prayer will be number 85. Number 85.
Good evening. This is Bill Shapley speaking for the congregation. I want to welcome each of you to our evening worship service. We especially appreciate our visitors and request that you fill out a visitor's card, which you can find on the back of a pew in front of you. The others serving in our worship tonight are Elijah Gilbert, directing our singing. Our opening prayer will be led by David Francis. Jerry and I will have our closing prayer. And, of course, our speaker will be Ron Gilbert. Among our announcements, the elders have drawn up bylaws for the congregation and welcome any input from the membership. They are posted on the bulletin board and in the foyer. These are scheduled to be adopted on the 18th today, pending any changes. October 31st at 4 p.m., the Comstocks are having a Halloween party at their home. November 1st, an elders meeting at 5 p.m. December 6th, the holiday dinner after the evening service. And there's a sign-up sheet, a Halloween sign-up sheet for refreshments. And please check the bulletin for the sick list, and please remember them in your prayers. And we'll now have the opening prayer.
Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we humble ourselves and praise your name. Hallowed be your great name. Father, we have so many blessings and privileges and freedoms. Well, help us to realize, Father, that along with all these great breaks that we have, there's a tremendous responsibility that goes with each one of us for everything, every privilege that we have and every break that we have compared so much more than many people in the world. Father, we know that you realize that all of the different problems are in the world and all the different potentials that come can change things in just a sudden thing throughout the world at any time, especially in our individual lives. Father, we ask you to, if it be your will, to try to bless each look in each life that we have of this congregation and everyone in our brotherhood, and try to give them a circle of protection and try to be with us and go with us and give us strength and courage to resist temptation and to carry on your work, that we might further your cause throughout the world and locally here in this local community. Father, as we continue to worship you, we ask you to be with the sick and afflicted and the different problems throughout this congregation, and if it be your will, to heal the people and give them comfort where they cannot be healed. We ask you to be with all of the older people as they're having many problems. Father, be with Ron this evening as he teaches a lesson from Revelations, as we try to learn some more from your word. Be with everyone in this congregation as we try to further your cause, and forgive our sins, Father, that help us to look forward to that great day in the eternal home of the soul, where we be no partings come and all will be joy forevermore. In Christ's name we pray, and amen.
Number 85. Number 161.
Good evening, brethren. Good to see everybody. We're certainly glad that you're here. If you'd like to be opening your Bibles up to Revelations chapter 2, we'll be in verses 18 through 29. The largest of the seven letters to the churches of Asia, and it happens to be one of the probably the most least significant city. Of course, if you live in Thyatira, you probably wouldn't appreciate that, but it's not as notable as the other seven, although it did have a Roman garrison there. But before we get started, I've got to share something with you. Had the privilege of worshiping with two other congregations today. Went down here to the Second Street Church and got to worship with those brethren immediately after our services today. Then I was asked by a good friend of mine up at the Grootley Church to preach up there this afternoon. As he was going on vacation, needed somebody to fill in. And so on the way home, I believe it's the first time in my 52 years of existence, riding in cars, I guess, that whole time that I can remember, that a turkey flew across the road in front of my vehicle. I've got Robbie Hughes as witness, and Robbie said, boy, I'm glad that thing was as high as it was, so you didn't hit it. And I was thinking about an early Thanksgiving if it had been a little lower. But I had never seen one take off and fly like that across the road. I don't think I've ever seen that before, but that was pretty neat. Thought I would share that with you. We're going to be looking tonight at the church, of course, at Thyatira. Let me show you a couple of things, though, that I thought was interesting. I think may be a stretch, but at the same time, I thought it was pretty interesting. Of course, Brother John would have been a great historian of the church, or of Judaism for sure. You know, he was very apt in all of the scriptures. But some things that were brought to my attention I thought was kind of interesting. In that, in the first church he talks to, he alludes to the paradise of God. I believe that is in verse 7. And so you go back about as far as you possibly can in the Old Testament to, you know, Genesis chapter 1 and 2. You talk about, he ties that in to the things that are going on with the church at Ephesus. Then the one that I think is a little bit of a stretch, but in verses 8 and following, we have the church at Smyrna. And notice he talks about the idea of the second death. And the fellow I was writing, and was making this allusion to the Old Testament, was talking about the second death of man actually came with the flood. And if you think about that, there is a sense of that. You had the, you know, the falling away in the garden. And then you had just about the complete destruction of all of men, the second death, he referred to it as, with the flood. Now that may be a little bit of a stretch, but maybe that has some allusion to that. But 3 and 4 are definitely talking about something. Notice Pergamos. Pergamos, he's going to use that old enemy of Israel, Balaam, if you remember, who was hired by Balak. And that's going to continue with tonight's church. He's going to look at another Old Testament situation. We're going to be talking about Jezebel. Of course, Jezebel was that Sidonian queen who was married by Ahab. And if she had done anything, she brought lasciviousness and idolatry, worship into Old Testament Israel. And with one of the things that we probably forget, if we knew, is that when we're talking about pagan worship, you're not just talking about some people getting together and having a worship service, singing some songs and some things of that nature. In order to be an artisan, if you will, to be in a trade guild, we have unions in our country, but they are nothing like these guilds would have been. Maybe some of the, you know, the wars and things they were having years ago when the unions, you know, were actually bloodshed and things of that nature. Maybe that kind of, you know, approaches it. But in order to be a particular guild or a particular artisan, be it brass work or leather work or whatever that particular field you were in, if you wanted to be successful in that, you needed to have the right connections. You needed to be, you know, you were in the business world, and you were going to be a worshiper of that particular guild's deity. And when you worshiped the pagan gods back in the day, you just didn't, go to a church building somewhere or a temple and, offer up a sacrifice and, you know, sing a few songs with folks and leave. They would have very elaborate services in which you'd have sacrifice of animals. They have feasts dedicated to these gods. They would also, a lot of times, end with and have orgies. And if you think, is that what I think it means? Yes, it means exactly what you think it means. I'm talking about fornication. I'm talking about adultery. I'm talking about things that were just despicable, but they used this, and you might say, how in the world is that even possible? Well, folks, I don't know. I don't know how you could tie that in with worship. I don't know how you could tie that in with the gods, but when you start thinking about the Greek gods and how lascivious they were when Zeus would leave heaven and come down, supposedly, and have carnal knowledge with a woman here and produce Hercules, I mean, their gods were just as wicked and immoral as any man would want to be, and so they didn't hesitate to practice these things. And that was one of the great things about Paul's missionary journeys. Remember what he writes to the Corinthian church: adulterers, fornicators, homosexuals, and such were you. Such were some of you, but now you've been washed, you've been cleansed. You no longer act that way. And so that's just really hard for me to get my rope around. How many of us can associate having sexual, immoral sexual relationships and that being counted as worship, as a wholesome thing to a god or to a deity? That's just beyond me. But even Corinth, remember the Acrocorinth, the very top place there, that was nothing but a big brothel. That's all it was. Now, they worship gods there, supposedly, but basically people went there for sexual activity. It would involve female prostitutes. It would involve male prostitutes. Every kind of wickedness that you can think of went on there. Well, one of the things we said we want to look at as we look at this book, we want to look at it through first century glasses. These are seven real letters being written to seven real churches that basically deal with all or a lot of the problems that all these churches were going to be going through. Notice in verse 18, now to help maybe hit this home for us a little bit, Thyatira, its major deity, and every town would have had one. Every town would have had its major deity, would have had its temple. Their deity was Apollo. Now Apollo, if you look him up, it's incredible what all they attributed to this god. Supposedly, he was a son of Zeus, and he was the god of the sun, light. He was the god of music. He was the god of poetry. And then if you start looking up some of the other things they gave to him, he was about the god of everything. But he was supposed to have these fiery eyes, you know, the sun god. And he was supposed to have these burnished brass feet, if you will. And I think that's what has allusion here in the introduction to the church at Thyatira. Notice what Jesus says. Unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God. How many times do you hear Jesus say that about himself? It doesn't happen a lot. In fact, I can't think of any other place than here where he says, I am the Son of God. And the reason that he's saying that, I believe, is just like the reason God attacked the firstborn in Egypt during the 10 plagues. Do you remember what the Pharaoh said he was? He was Ra incarnate. He was the God, the Zeus, if you will, of Greek mythology. He was the Ra. He was the God. He was God incarnate, and his son would have been what? You get it, Son of God. And so what did the God of heaven show? You're no God. You can't even protect your son. And so here we have God, Jesus, saying, saith the Son of God, notice, who hath the eyes like a flame unto fire, and his feet are like fine brass. Now this fits in perfectly well with the description we see of Jesus in chapter 1, but I believe that is highlighted here because of the fact that they were this group, this town that was dedicated to the worship of Apollo. Let's continue reading verse 19. He says, I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and patience, and thy works. Now, in the King James, that looks like a tautology, a repetition of words, where he starts off with, I know your works, names four, then talks about the works again. But I think some of the newer translations, I believe the American Standard may have even done this, they move the semicolon and to say that the last works are greater than the first is the idea there. And that's probably from better manuscript that they do that. So it's not works twice. But notice some of the great things that are mentioned about this church. First of all, it's a working church. It's not a lazy congregation. It's folks that are getting out there, they're doing something. They're a working congregation. And notice he says, and of your great love. This is a loving church. This is a church that has concern for each its members. It has concern for the community. It is a church that loves. And notice it is a helpful church. It's a service-based church. These brethren are helping folks. They're concerned about people. They want to do good, and they're helping. So he says, I know your works. They do. They're a working church, your love, your service. And you're a trusting congregation. They were a faithful church. They trusted in God, and notice that one word, and thy patience, thy hupomone, the ability to stand up under pressure. They were patient. And he says that your last works are greater than the first works. So they're a congregation that is moving forward, and all looks well, doesn't it? It looks like a great thing. This is good. Man, what could be wrong with this? Well, they have a problem. Notice it says, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee. Jesus has told them good things. You know, the Apostle Paul would do that in his writings. He would bring out things that were happening good at that congregation. And then he would say, you know, while we're talking about this, let's look at some things that we could work on. And basically that's what Jesus is doing here, but it's a lot more forceful. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. You have a false teacher in the church at Thyatira. Probably not standing in the pulpit. She's probably not teaching a class there, but subversely behind the scenes. Now, whether this is talking about a particular woman, doubt very seriously if her name was Jezebel. There was a tradition that this was the preacher's wife, because it says, and thou sufferest thy wife, Jezebel, because some people have translated that in the past, because remember what we've talked about with the word wife and woman? It's just the word gune, G-U-N-E, is how we'd write it in English, and you have to look at the context as to what it means. I don't believe it's the wife of the preacher. I believe it's a particular woman. Don't think her name was Jezebel. But that's just what Jesus is using to show the great wickedness. Notice what she's doing. First of all, she says, I'm a prophetess. I'm speaking for God. And what else was she doing? Teaching. Here you've got somebody trying to teach Christians that it's okay to fornicate. So basically what you have here, and you've probably heard this before, I was taught this as a little fella when I was going to denominational church, that whatever sins the body does, well, that doesn't really account to the soul. You see, the spirit and the flesh, they're different. I know most brethren, if you've not had exposure outside of the church, you're saying, he's got to be making that up. I'm not. And here you've got somebody in the first century who's trying to do that very thing. She is trying to teach Christians that it's okay to go to these orgies. It's okay to go to these pagan worship temples and eat things that are sacrificed to idols, even though you know this was offered up to a pagan god, and you're at a feast that's honoring that pagan god. She's saying, that's okay. Don't you worry about it. You got to have a job. You got to work. And if you want to be a part of the trade guild, that's what you need to do. And yes, you got to stay around and have those orgies that they're having afterwards. If you want to be an upstanding citizen in the working, and she's basically teaching them it's okay. And one of the things that a lot of folks have done over the past, it's amazing when you read things about this, have taught that you need to sin a little. You need to get out there and sin a little so that you know what it's about. You can actually see the depths of Satan, if you will. And once you've been out there and you've tasted that, then you realize that's what we're against. And that's what we need to not be doing. You know, the Amish practice the Mennonites? Brethren, I can't remember. One of those two groups practice that, where they actually let the kids go away. And they go out and, spend some time on the world and see if that's what they want to do, or they want to stay there with the community. But that's the idea. Sow those wild oats, if you will. Here she's teaching them to do things that are totally wrong, and she's doing it by saying, to the church. Verse 21, notice, and I gave her space. The word space there is the Greek word chronos. A lot of your translations will translate that time. It's where we get our word chronology, time, calendar, chronology. And so I believe that, the idea there, better than space or room to repent, is the idea of time to repent of her fornication. And she repented not. She had opportunity, but she's not going to take advantage of that. Once again, I believe this is not talking about a particular woman named Jezebel, but this prophetess that's teaching. Verse 22, behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her, into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. So here you have this church doing some great things. They're a working church. They care about each other. They're loved. They have faithfulness. They have trust. But they've got this working in the back room. There's maybe even the elders there don't even know it's taking place, but it is taking place, and it's having its effect. And notice, Jesus says, I'm going to hold her accountable. I gave her time to repent. She hasn't. And notice, I'm also going to hold those that don't repent of their deeds guilty as well. He says, I will kill her children with death. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins. The word reins there is the word that means the kidneys. I searcheth the reins or kidneys and hearts. That's a lot like us saying mind and soul, you know. Your whole, you know, emphasizing for them the kidneys, the heart was the, you know, essence of man, if you will, his infrastructure. And so when we might say your mind and your heart or something of that nature, that's the idea. He says in all the churches, notice this was to be a public example. The church was going to have to deal with Jezebel. They were going to have to practice discipline with her. And because all the churches needed to see this, this is what takes place. Jesus says, I am he that searcheth the reins and the heart. Remember when he described himself as having those fiery eyes, all-seeing eyes, all-powerful, all-knowing? He says, I will give unto every one of you according to your works. Over and over again in the book of Revelation, you will see that. They're going to be judged by their works. Works have something to do with it, folks, our denominational friends notwithstanding. Verse 24, but unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, a lot of the newer translations say, but unto you at Thyatira, not the idea of there being a separate group. He's talking to the same group. As many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan. See that idea, depths of Satan? That's where I get the idea that maybe she's teaching them that you need to go out there and you need to get and understand the depths of Satan. And you can't do that unless you're worshiping in the pagan temples and fornicating and things of this nature. He says, the depths of Satan as they speak. Notice that's something they say. And I will put on you none other burden. But that which you already have, hold fast until I come. This morning we were talking about the miracle in Matthew chapter 12. And that's that word hold fast. Is the idea Jesus used to talk to them about going and you'd grab hold of your animal to take it to water. He says, but that which you have already, hold fast till I come again. You know, be faithful, continue as you're doing. Verse 26, and he says, and he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him I will give power over the nations. I believe this is the same idea we see. If you mark your place there, in Revelation chapter 2, and turn with me, if you will, to the book of Psalms. Psalms chapter 2, because I believe this is dealing with the same thing. Psalms chapter 2, we'll get down, I think it was about verse 9. Tell you what, let's back on up to verse 7. Psalms chapter 2, verse 7, I will declare the decree the Lord hath said unto me, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Can't help but see that echoed in the first part of this letter when he says, the Son of God. You know, Jesus says, I am the Son of God, this day have I begotten thee. Verse 8, ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, the othermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with a wrought iron, thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. The idea there of ruling the nations is the idea of ruling and reigning with the Christ. What we're doing now, the life that we live, that what we're going through now in a sense is ruling the world and condemning the world. Because the way that we live our lives and the church functioning in this world shows that it can be done. Do you remember when Jesus was talking to Jerusalem and he says, Tyre and Sidon, you know, here this wicked group, they would repent it at the works, if they had seen the works that you're seeing. He said, Tyre and Sidon would have repented. He says, therefore, they will be your judges. You see, in a sense, they were living a life to judge even Israel. And I believe that's what that's speaking about there. And then verse 27, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron as the vessels of a potter, shall they be broken to shivers. Of course, that's what we just read in Psalms 2. Even as I received of my father, which would allude to chapter 2, verse 7 of the Psalms. Verse 28, and I will give him the morning star. What in the world is the morning star? Well, I tell you what, if you own 25 commentaries on the book of Revelation, you'll probably have 23 to 25 different answers. But what I think that's talking about, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Revelations chapter 22. Revelations chapter 22, and look at verse 16. Easy to remember because we think Acts 22, 16, you know. Now why tarry us thou, right? Revelation 22, verse 16 says, I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. It's just hard for me to think that the same author, John, would use an allusion or use something in chapter 22 at verse 16 that means something totally different than it would have meant in chapter 2, verse 28. So I think that's when he's talking about himself. I will give him the morning star. I will give him the Christ myself. He'll be a part of me, if you will. I think that's what that's alluding to there. Now in verse 29, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. All seven of these letters will end in the same way. People want to say the Spirit's talking to them today. The Spirit's talking to me. But how's he doing it? Just the same way he was talking to these seven churches of Asia, and that is through the written word, through the inspiration of God's word. Of course, we know where we are. Now we're going to start heading south. We started over here to Ephesus and went up to Smyrna and to Pergamum. Now we're going to be going down to Thyatira. It was a great trade route. A lot of guilds there, a lot of jobs there. It was good work. But like we said before, it was never known as a major city. It did have a garrison. But if you'll remember, the water there, apparently, if you've ever fooled with water much or dying, you'll know water's pretty important. One of the advantages we have today, though, is we can adjust water chemically. That's what I did for many years down in Dalton, dyed carpet, and we would make the water what we needed as far as pH levels and things of that nature to dye, to set the dye, and then even to, rinse it and so forth. The water at Thyatira was great for dyeing linen, and they had this purple dye that they would use, and hence it was world renowned. If you went to the market, if you wanted to get purple stuff, you wanted to get garments that were dyed in Thyatira. Hence, in Acts chapter 16, you remember Lydia. Now, what was she? She was a businesswoman. She had purple cloth. Where'd she live? Where was she from? She is from Thyatira. And so we're going to continue going south as we look at the rest of these churches. But you can find this place today. It is pronounced Ach Eser. And it's important you give it that sound, or you'll offend some folks. That's how they say that, Ach Eser. And it's a very large city today. It's on a pretty good trade route, but it's landlocked, as you could see. And this is what the main part of town looks like now. Here's the Turkish soldier that actually turned this into a republic, and he's highly looked at it. But right slap in the middle of this thing is this ancient church. And it's also, beside it was the Agora. They think this is probably from the Byzantine period, which would make it, 300, 600 A.D., somewhere up in there. But that's pretty neat. The church was such an important part of life and in Thyatira, even a few hundred years after that. Of course, we're looking at Thyatira, Jezebel's church, manipulation, intimidation, and domination. And we think the thing that pops in my mind about the church at Thyatira is the wrath of Jesus. Most of the time when we think about Jesus, we think the Savior. Jesus, we see him as the Lamb, but you realize he's also the Lion of Judah. And that he came once as the Savior, but when he comes back, it's not going to be to save men. It's going to be to judge. It's going to be to destroy this world. The wrath of the Lamb, we're going to look at it from five different ways. It's reality, it's severity, it's forbearance, and it's justice, and it's discrimination. First of all, it's reality. The church offered no real opposition to Jezebel's teaching. And therefore, they're falling under condemnation of the Lord. Now, maybe it was that some folks there didn't know about it, but apparently it was well known enough that it should have been addressed. And that's what Jesus said. You need to address this, and it needs to be so that all the other churches can see it as well. Sin must be dealt with. That's why we find the church at Thessalonica being encouraged to withdraw from those who would not work, don't let him eat, from those who stole, from all that, from those that walked disorderly, which has the idea of walking out of step. Sin must be dealt with. And we see in verse 23, so that the churches could see it. In verse 23, it was a public thing. Also, the wrath of the Lamb is severity. Notice with me, if you will, in verses 22, I will cast her into bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. I will kill her children with death. That means those that would follow her, what she was teaching, not her offspring. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the mind, the soul, if you will, and I will give unto every one of you according to his words. God does this even today. God does this even today with men and debauchery. God will allow a man to go as far as he wants to. If you will, turn with me, if you will, in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, we're going to see the world, we're going to see the Gentile world, and I hope a bunch of y'all have cellular phones that you're looking at up on, because I don't see here any pages turning. Romans chapter 1, that's it. Somebody shake them real good. At least make it sound that way. There we go. Notice in Romans chapter 1, verse 24, wherefore God also gave them up unto uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts. You see, if a man wants to, God is going to say, go do whatever you want to do. That's what you want to do? You want to ruin your life? You want to destroy your body? You want to take those drugs? You want to have that fornication? You want to run with the world? Then you go ahead. I'm not going to stop you. You are a free moral agent. God is going to make that possible. He's going to let them up to the uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts. That's how James says lust deceives. To dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up into vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. God says, do whatever they want to do. Let them go. And man will get so twisted and so perverted in that he won't even be able to look at something as natural as the husband and wife relationship, the male, the female relationship. He won't even keep that right. You let him do whatever he wants to, and he'll go to the basest of things. And we see that very thing acting out itself right now. Verse 27 says, and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly and receiving in themselves the recompense of their error, which was meet. In other words, they were suffering through things because of their lifestyle then, just as men today suffer through things because of their lifestyle. You want to talk about the home, and you want to talk about two men trying to raise a child or two women trying to raise a child, and you can try to pretty that up with Hollywood all that you want to, but the reality of the fact is it doesn't work. We're raising up a whole generation that has no concept of the mother, the father, the idea of life as we have known it. Our country is trying to change that, but it's not going to happen. You know, the way I know that's not going to happen, because Jesus says when he comes back, the people are going to be given in marriage. And he's not talking about men of men. It's not an institution we're just going to be able to wipe away. It's going to be here. But you allow men to do whatever they want to, and they can't take something so basic as a man and as a woman. That's what it takes to procreate. That's what it takes to have a family. Everybody can see that. You can't have children without the male and the female. You can't continue to exist as a society, as a people, if you can't get that right, and yet you allow men to just go and depart from God, and that's where they'll go. There's nothing stopping them. And do we think it's going to stop there? You know, you see us kind of chasing our tail, don't you? We're chasing our tail. We're wanting everything to be healthier. We need healthier food. We're taking pork out of the prison system. Isn't that great? You can't have a ham sandwich if you're a federal prisoner anymore. I'm just so glad we're doing that. Isn't that really going to help society? Isn't that really where we want to go with that? The cheapest meat that you can buy. Maybe now we can, But anyway, we don't want to do that. Let's give them top-of-the-line beef or something of that nature. But here's what I mean. We want to decriminalize drug use. We want to make drugs just as acceptable as they possibly can be. We talk about the different things that we're trying to do, such as human trafficking. Why are humans trafficked anyway? Generally, it's because of the sexual business. And yet, what are we trying to do? Different places have already done this, legalizing brothels. Well, in order to have legalized brothels, you got to have brothelies. You got to have somebody working there. Where are they getting these people? Well, they're bringing them in, and they're doing this thing, and yet here we are saying it's okay to have this kind of business, and yet we're trying to do things like stop. It's enough to make angels weep. It's enough to make angels weep. You let men do what they want to do, and they'll go as far as they can from that which is right. Notice in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, if you would, turn there with me. The same idea is brought out again. And what is happening? Men turn their life from God, saying, I don't want to do that. And the bottom line is, God's not going to stop. He's not going to throw a lasso around you. He's going to let you go where you want to go. Notice, it says in verse 9 of chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians, it says, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because why are they perishing? They receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. For this cause God shall send them a strong delusion, that they shall believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. God's going to make it easy. Men are going to turn away from God. They're going to dream up things like evolution. Don't you know that many a people have died and left this world thinking, hey, you know what? It's good. I'm going to be just like Rover. I'm going to be dead all over because I ain't nothing but a fancy bug anyway, lucky dirt, and woke up in torments thinking, my God, what has happened to me? Lord, I didn't know. It's one of the great fallacies of human existence to come up with the idea that somehow we're nothing but dirt and some exploded, and yet you have people buying into that all of the time. Ecclesiastes 8 at verse 11 says, because a sentence against an evil work is not carried out or executed speedily, the hearts of men are set to do evil. And boy, we see that more and more in our land all the time. The wrath of the Lamb is forbearance. Notice he gave them time to repent. When we think about God and his long-suffering, we think about our lives and how that God has been long-suffering to us. And the book of 2 Peter, if you turn there with me, I know you're familiar with this passage, but I'd like to read it with you. It's meant a lot to me in times past, continues to mean a lot to me. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, he's closing up the book. He says in verse 9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. You see, in 2 Peter chapter 3, there are some folks saying, you know, there's no God. If there had been, he'd already done something about all this. Look how nasty this is. Look how terrible everything is. And, you know, that's what Peter says was the exact same thing they were saying during the days of Noah. But that, notice in verse 5, the earth standing out of water and in the water, whereby the world that was then being overflowed with water perished. That's what they thought back then. That's what they thought in Noah's day. Well, God's not going to do anything. He's indifferent. If there is a God, he's indifferent. He ain't going to do anything, and hence the flood. And that's the context that we find verse 9 in. God's not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Isn't that a great thing? Aren't you thankful for that? I am so thankful for that. So many times in my life, if the Lord had decided to return then, I would have been in torments. I guess at that point we'd go to hell if he came back and we were judged that day. I'm thankful for the long suffering of God, but I'm also aware of the next verse. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. You don't know when the thief's going to come. He doesn't tell you. In which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also, and the works that are therein shall be burned up, done, gone over. God says, Jesus here says, I gave Jezebel time to repent. Think about my life. Think about your life. We have opportunity this side of judgment, this side of the end of our lives. But on the other side, we don't want to be like Jezebel. We don't want to wait too long. Notice it's justice. The flood. God looked at the earth and it repented him that he had made man. The wickedness of men was great. The Bible says every thought and intent of man's heart was corrupt. What a despicable picture. We think it's bad now. Imagine what it was then. God took care of it. Think of Sodom and Gomorrah. Why, even the angels were considered sexual, whatever you'd say for those guys. They wanted those men. They were destroyed. The Egyptians destroyed. The Canaanites wiped out as a people. What does God say in Leviticus 18? They're gone because you had daddies who were taking their daughters. You had mothers who were sleeping with their sons. You had men lying with men as with women. You had all this debauchery going there. And God says, don't you do that, or you're going to be just like them, and the very land itself will vomit you out. That's his words, not mine. The Canaanites, destroyed. Why? Because of their wickedness. Israel, the northern kingdom, destroyed. Why? Paganism, the idolatry. The Assyrians destroyed Israel. What happened to the Assyrians? A group of folks called the Chaldeans, the Medes and the Chaldeans. Judah, taken away into captivity for 70 years, punished. It goes on and on. The Chaldeans, the Roman Empire, you go wherever you want to with it. God will and does execute his justice. And then last but not least, it's discrimination. Even with this congregation, you had some folks that weren't caught up in that. You see, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 says, "Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal." And aren't we thankful? "The Lord knoweth them that are his." God knows us. And as we're going to see in the book of Revelation, the imagery of being stamped in the forehead, the imagery of being marked, the image of being sealed. God knows who are his. "And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." Good advice for anybody at any time. "But unto you and unto the rest," or to ever there that Thyatira, as many that don't have this sin, what does he say? "Hold fast." The idea there is to seize, to grab hold of, to become the master of. You've got it, don't let it go. How many Christian brethren do we know of that are not here tonight, weren't here this morning, haven't seen them in months, who instead of laying hold on to that, have let it go? They've let it go. Maybe people in our own family who we know are someplace else. They're not attending services. Not that they would attend here, but they're in our family. We're aware of them. They used to be faithful, but no longer are. They haven't laid hold any longer. Revelation 2:25, look at what God said he'll do for us, for me, for you. "Hold fast till I come, and I will give you the power over the nations. And them that rule the iron rod," he quoting, of course, here from Psalms 2, verse 9. Verse 28, "the morning star," Christ himself. And, of course, he asks and tells the church there that if you have the ear, listen what the Spirit says in the church. What about you? What about me? Do we listen what the Spirit says? We have warning after warning in the New Testament. Not only to obey the gospel, to take the grace of God, accept the great blessing that Jesus has given us in dying for us on the cross. Maybe in times past you've done so, but you've left your first love. Let's take advantage of that. Let's take advantage of the opportunity we have on this side of 2 Peter chapter 3 at verse 10. Because on the other side, well, the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. We have no hope after the end of this life to be saved in the next, as is illustrated in Luke 16, the rich man, Lazarus. It's in this life where we must make things right with God. If we can help you in any way, we encourage you to come as together we stand and sing. Oh, do not let the